Marley was dead, to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. So begins a little novella that has endured and flourished for over 150 years and survived, mostly unscathed through numerous adaptations from radio to theater to film to animated movie to 3D motion capture movie. Is there a VR version out there where you can slap on the Oculus goggles and get a visit from the three ghosts to review your regret and poor choices? Sign me up! Dickens finally makes his way to Book of the Day. Here we go! We're back on Book of the Day, a very special show, I think. We just started this experiment, this grand experiment in October, and we haven't had a chance to do anything Christmassy around here. So here we are with the big Christmas carol and, of course, our own version of Jacob Marley. Steve Donahue.
Hello, everybody.
Rattle your chains for us, will you?
Considering the week we've had, my esteemed producer approached his microphone with trepidation, wondering if I was going to take shots at one of the most beloved works of literature in all of the canon. I'm not.
Good.
Child and the baby for this episode. We are, of course, talking about Charles Dickens' 1849 classic, A Christmas Carol, which has never been out of print, which has been reprinted 80 gazillion times, adapted into every form of plastic art imaginable. Including the Muppets.
I love that one, by the way.
It's one of the better carols.
Michael Caine is obviously just having a grand time in that movie.
Yeah. There are all sorts of, this is the story. I'm sure that unless we've got listeners from Mars, which would be great, but unless we do, everybody knows this story. But this is the story of a businessman named Ebenezer Scrooge in London, who is one half of Marley and Scrooge, but Marley has been dead for years. When he is a miserable, cramped old man who does not like his own family, brutalizes his one worker, and thinks that Christmas is a humbug. And he is visited by spirits. And people often say, when they're just offhandedly recalling this book, that he's visited by three spirits. But that's not true. He's actually visited by four. Jacob Marley visits him first of all.
He's kind of the maitre d' who brings him to the table.
Right. Yes. He comes to announce to Scrooge that he will be visited by the ghosts of Christmas past, present, and yet to come. Mm-hmm. But, and the ghost of Christmas yet to come is the Grim Reaper. He's a masked, totally silent figure who points Ebenezer Scrooge at his own tombstone.
My personal favorite, by the way.
To my mind, the scariest spirit by far has always been Jacob Marley. This is a guy who knew Scrooge,
yeah,
and who tells him, he's wearing a chain, a massive, ponderous chain that it can't give him any rest, and it drags behind him a very long thing that is made up of the ills and sins that he committed on earth. Mm-hmm. And he tells Scrooge that when I died 7 years ago, your chain was this long, and now it's beyond counting. He's also the only one of the spirits who's trying to be scared. He jumps up and yells and rattles when Scrooge has the nerve to think that he might be a bit of indigestion.
Can we talk about that indigestion a bit? So as a kid, and even as an adult, there is a potentiality here that none of this actually occurred, and it was just that. I mean, I don't want to pop up, but there's some magic to that.
If that's true. Yes, if it's true that Scrooge just imagined all of this, then you'd like to think that the narrative presents us with an inciting incident. Why did it happen this particular night?
Right.
Was it that it was Christmas? Scrooge doesn't care about Christmas. Was it the visit from his nephew?
Right.
His nephew visits him in his business and says, why can't we be friends? And Scrooge has no interest in it whatsoever. No. We can presume that his nephew has visited him before. It could all be his imagination, but the beauty of the story is, there are a number of, it's a very entertaining story.
Absolutely.
But the beauty of it is the idea, the sense of redemption.
Yes.
That even the worst person in the world, Scrooge is the worst person in the world when we meet him. The idea that such a person can come to a self-realization is a kind of a perennial dream, right?
Indeed.
Everybody sure.
Although you say he's the worst possible person, then of course, 2022 says, hold my beer, as they say.
Well,
we talked about this week here on the show, even.
Yeah. You always wish that somebody who seems completely dead set on a course, and Scrooge is, he's been this way for decades, mm-hmm. will change their course to live a better way. And the neat thing, one of the neat things about A Christmas Carol is that the better way is secular. It's not linked to any one religion.
Right.
I know that critics have said that this is a Christian thing, but the mentions of Christianity are slow. They're incidental. The spirits are most resolutely not Christian. Mm-mm. They're not anything. They're just the embodiments of your regrets, your present life, and your future fears, mm-hmm. which everybody has. And I reread this often, this book. I don't make a ritual of reading it at Christmas time, but I do reread it often. I reread it recently in 2022 and was struck by a couple of things that may or may not be of interest. I'm assuming that everybody listening to this episode has read this at least once.
Or at least maybe seen an adaptation.
A lot of people haven't. Maybe they've seen an adaptation and haven't read the book. And that would be a shame. An old literary savant in Boston used to tell me that the way you can tell that a book is a classic is if people are surprised to learn that it had an author, because it's just become part of
just the vernacular
in the cultural conversation. Yeah. Jekyll and Hyde would be a good example, or A Christmas Carol, Ebenezer Scrooge, Bah Humbug, all that sort of thing. Peter Pan, Winnie the Pooh.
As aspiring authors, we should be so lucky to come up with such a thing.
Yes, it seems that luck seems to have lit on the Victorians to an exorbitant degree, far more than it does to anybody else.
Right.
You talk to somebody about the Invisible Man, and they'll say, "Oh, yeah, I think that originated with the Greeks." No, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, the Invisible Man, Around the World in 80 Days, you name it, almost comes from the Victorians. But one of the things that I noticed this time around is how long it takes Scrooge to change his mind or even to really seriously consider it. He attacks the Ghost of Christmas Past.
Yes.
you almost never see it filmed, but he attacks her and puts her down in a cone.
Oh my, I don't recall that. I'll have to
He extinguishes her like a candle flame.
Oh yes, that's right. I do remember that.
And
that's
the
right.
Ghost of Christmas Present, Scrooge is surly and, you know, mouthy the whole time. He is by no means, when the actual interaction ends, he's by no means converted. Even the Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come. Only really, you can boil down his conversion moment to seeing his own grave.
Yeah.
And when you really read that, you're wondering, okay, well, Scrooge is an incredible realist and he's an old man. Is it really that terrifying that he's someday going to die? Is that really going to happen? I mean, would that really be the absolute bolt from the blue realization that I must change my ways? When I come up the stairs from getting the day's mail, I feel like I'm going to die. Wouldn't Scrooge have had that feeling at least once? I don't know. Another thing that I noticed this time around when I was reading reinforces something that same literary savant used to tell me. When we would talk about various books, and when I would mention A Christmas Carol, I would say, "So it's all about human regret and remaking our ways," and he would always scoff and say, "No, it's about all the bad things that happen to you if you give up reading." And when I reread the book, I realized that is true.
Really?
When Scrooge is looking at himself as a boy alone in a schoolroom, he protests that he is not alone, that he's surrounded by, you know, Robinson Crusoe and all the figures from Treasure Island and Robinson.
Sure.
They come about him. In fact, they almost count as spirits on their own. They are visible. He was an active, loving reader, a passionate reader. And we're not talking about him being just a little boy.
Yeah.
Stayed in that cold exile for years till he was a young man. But there's no hint of that later. The books that are in Marley and Scrooge are all accounting books.
Oh, well, the lightning bolt moment of this episode for a library is that of course, is that to avoid becoming a miserable old wretch, you have to get down here and get those stacks of bugs. Don't stop.
And I love to it. Avoid dealing with a miserable old wretch, maybe don't start a podcast with a Boston Bruin.
The double-edged wisdom that we are imparting today. I love it.
Dead. That much was certain.
Visited by Jeff Bezos, wrapped in chains. That was a reference to another.
Who knows how many vengeful ghosts we'll have racked up.
We will have to remain in touch over the holiday. Well, there's no problem getting your hands on this. It's actually been digitized across the board. You can come and get a hard copy here. But
the question that I had for you to wrap things up for this holiday episode, I guess.
Yes.
What is the selection like in the Monarch Library system?
Oh,
for various editions or things.
Extensive, sure. I mean, I think there's got to be like an Everyman collection of Dickens pieces, and I mean, it's everywhere. There's a very lovely larger form, almost like picture book versions. Just pick your flavor: vanilla, chocolate, strawberry, Neapolitan. We got it all,
and it's popular. It does.
This time of year, you do see some action on it, which, again,
in that case, it hasn't been affected at all by the fact that you can download it for free.
No, certainly not. I think a lot of people want to hold this. They want to have it, you know.
I'm actually wondering right now if I have the...
Somewhere by the penguin.
Oh, no. I have the guinea pig Romeo and Juliet and the guinea pig Pride and Prejudice. I have the guinea pig Night Before Christmas.
Okay, very good.
But not a guinea pig Christmas. Not a guinea pig Christmas Carol.
What poor pig would have to be relegated to Scrooge? I wonder. It's the saddest thing ever. But I've heard
from their owners, their poor benighted owners, if you don't give piggies exactly the treat they want at exactly the moment they want, they start flinging around their bedding.
I had four at one time.
So. I've heard from people that they can be very unruly little monsters.
They are. Well, they're fascinating because what I love about them, this podcast is wild. They actually will. They are the most useless creatures on this earth because they exist only as prey. So they have a continual thought. I think the thought that's constantly going through your mind is, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, I'm about to die. I don't think it ever stops. But eventually they do bond with you a bit, and they are actually lovely creatures and fun to spend your time with. But even at your most bonded, any sudden movements, like, I knew it, they're going to kill me. So they're interesting.
There's a motto for the season as well.
Yes.
If you want to live your life constantly thinking, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, I'm about to die, then once again, don't start a podcast with an old motto.
Yes, indeed. And with that,
it's all over the place. It's a Christmas miracle.
I opened my email server with hesitation. Well, yes, but it's been a lovely Christmas episode. I've always wanted to do one of these, and now it's in the books. A Christmas Carol. Interestingly enough, here in the Milwaukee area, we have a relatively renowned stage version of A Christmas Carol that's been going on for decades. Same performers at our wonderful Pabst Theater. Beautiful. If you can dial up some images of this.
Is it a tradition?
Very much so.
Is it possible? This would be too good to be true, but is it possible that the actor who plays Bob Cratchit once played Tiny Tim?
It's very, you know what? That's very possible. I can't say for sure, but this has been long running for 30 years, probably longer. And again, at this gorgeous Pabst Theater. And so I actually dialed up before the broadcast. I was curious. There are very limited seats left over the next 4 days. You're going to be in the galley, rear left galley. That's where you're sitting. But people will do it. And it's a family tradition. Families do this. And it's very cool. It's an interesting
thing. My first thought was that maybe Cats has also become a generational thing. But then I remembered that once a performer has played in Cats for 10 years, they kill themselves. No generational things, no. Right now.
Well, if they didn't kill themselves after the film adaptation, I don't know. I don't know what will. So anyway.
We have a Christmas Carol episode that demonstrates perfectly how well we do with staying on topic.
Not too bad today. Wow, B minus for both of us.
We've been 20 minutes talking about guinea pigs. Somewhere, Charles Dickens is spinning in his grave.
Well,
to the bones, and you're talking about guinea pigs.
Hey, the man who wrote Bleak House should be doing a little spinning, if you ask me. But anyway, all right, folks, that is your Christmas episode. And, you know, coming from a Jewish guy, you can take this to the bank. Merry Christmas to you, Steve, and Merry Christmas to our listeners.
Merry Christmas to all of you.
Take care. Thank you.